Very good evening, Master Liu and distinguished guests. Thank you very much for joining us for the opening program of Liu Kuo-sung Experimentation as Method. I hope everyone here has had a chance to see the exhibition which opened to the public this morning. Experimentation as Method is the largest exhibition of Master Liu's works and archival materials ever to be shown in Singapore, with more than 60 paintings and 150 items from the artist's personal archives. This retrospective highlights the groundbreaking feats of artistic innovation by Master Liu made throughout his long career. Master Liu is an artist who has played a leading role in the modernization of Chinese ink painting. With an independent artistic spirit, he pushes the boundaries of existing methods in his constant pursuit of new techniques and ways of expression. He boldly abandoned the conventions of traditional ink painting, which are primarily based on imitative learning and calligraphic brushwork, and instead considers individual experimentation to be a fundamental method for creation. This approach has revealed the expressive potential of ink and paper and transformed the conventional system of traditional ink painting into a modern and contemporary ink discourse that embraces openness and diversity. Master Liu's paintings have often been described as abstract, yet the term fails short of meaningfully describing the full range of his work, which draws from disparate influences and span all of seven decades. They have been more accurately described as psychocosmographic inkscapes, which better lends itself to the dynamism and complexity of Master Liu's ink paintings, and hint at the more incorporeal aspects of his practice. Here to elaborate on these facets of Master Liu's practice is the esteemed Professor Eugene Wang. Professor Wang is the Abby Aldrich Rockefeller Professor of Asian Art at Harvard University, Art History Editor of the Encyclopedia of Buddhism, and a Guggenheim Fellow. His publications range from early to modern and contemporary Chinese art, and he has received the Sakamoto Nichijin Academic Award from Japan for his book, Shaping the Lotus Sutra, Buddhist Visual Culture in Medieval China. He's a founding director of Harvard Chem Lab that explores sensorial experiential staging of Asian cultural heritages. Professor Wang also shares a close friendship with Master Liu, no doubt allowing intimate insight into the artist's creative philosophies and practice. We are immensely grateful and privileged to have both Professor Wang and Master Liu share their perspectives with us today. Well, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Eugene Wang for his lecture, Post-abstraction and Transcendence, the Inscape of Liu Kuo-sung's Inkscapes.
Thank you for this very nice, generous introduction. My namesake, Eugene Tan, I want to thank you and Curator Cai Heng and all the team. And I also want to congratulate you on this extraordinary exhibition that celebrates the long career of Liu Kuo-sung. Ink painting as a medium has a comeback. It has been sitting in the back seat for a while when contemporary art was all the rage, and what represent contemporary art typically would be the installation. So for a while, ink painter felt neglected, but now there's a full comeback, especially among Asian artists who feel deeply the connection of this medium to the cultural memory and the roots. So when we speak of ink painting, it's hard not to speak of Liu Kuo-sung, who really modernized the medium. And to the extent that there's a claim, which I think is well-founded, that is one of, at least, if not the, but certainly one of the founding fathers of modern ink painting. Now, so today, what I'm going to do is to ask two questions. One is, how did Liu Kuo-sung become Liu Kuo-sung? The second question is, how do we remember Liu Kuo-sung's art? How do we best describe Liu Kuo-sung's art? So typically, one thinks of he's one of the pioneers in abstract painting. And in fact, that makes things more complicated that he, in fact, in the 1960s, he himself openly advocated for abstract painting. But this came with a cost because a lot of detractors who resist what he was doing pick on him on the ground that abstract painting is undesirable, and a lot of times there's a lot of criticism, and then they forget what he was doing, but they just say, well, abstract art is bad in general. So in a way, he was treated unfairly on that ground. So one way of moving forward or clarify the matter is to say that actually, he was into abstract painting, but there's more. So today I want to show you a review, there's more. And what is that more that we remember or we best describe Liu Kuo-sung's art? Right. So to give you a sense of why abstract painting doesn't fully capture what it does, I can start with this painting and also examine how typically we go about describe a painting or remember a painting or tag a painting. The way we typically do it is to find a source and establish some kind of causal relationship. You say, well, there's someone else doing this earlier on, then it must be that he was borrowing from someone else, and that explains what he's doing. So this is actually widely unfair. So in this case, you might say, well, okay, Adolf Gottlieb influenced Liu Kuo-sung, and therefore, and they're both abstract paintings, therefore Liu Kuo-sung followed the steps of Gottlieb. And that's grossly unfair for both painters, because each was doing his own thing. And there's always individual stories behind the what might be generally termed abstract painting. So that doesn't quite work. What about another one? Let's choose another painting by Liu Kuo-sung and then say, okay, how do we, if we say, okay, he's not really that much into, or abstract painting might not be the adequate term to describe him, how about that we align him with the tradition? That's often done as well. And Liu Kuo-sung himself also happily, delightedly, talk about his painting in that way. So we all know for certain that when he first saw Fan Kuan's painting circa 1000, he was so blown away by it. It actually gave him both goosebumps. And so he created this painting in response to Fan Kuan's painting. And then you might say, oh, okay, he's a traditionalist. And that's actually also a very bad description because he's doing something more than what Fan Kuan is doing, and I'll come back to that. And he himself also wants to align his painting with some of the earlier masters, such as Shi Ke. It's actually a 13th century painting, but often attributed to the 10th century painter, but that's another matter. But the point is that Liu Kuo-sung also find this kind of what is called a wild cursive brushstroke quite invigorating, and so he certainly subscribed to this line of indebtedness. So you might say, okay, so essentially we can use the planarity of this monumental landscape, put it there, and we put the wild cursive script down, and that composite makes this painting. And problem solved. But that's actually, again, is too mechanistic and doesn't really describe what he's doing within this painting. And so I'll come back to this in a minute. But just to long to say, I show both paintings to to say that you would do him injustice by aligning him only to abstract painting on the one hand and to the traditional painting on the other. Neither would fully capture the dynamic of what he's doing. All right. So that's the key point I'm making. What about technique? Because he's also known for revolutionized the brushstrokes and wouldn't subscribe to the center brush approach that characterized traditional Chinese painting. So he invented all kinds of techniques, and he's one of those who fully discover or explore how to build a painting rather than just paint a painting, how to explore the material properties of ink and paper medium and build a painting, like building an architecture. So that, of course, is part of what he's doing. But then if you say all his art is reduced to a matter of finding material techniques, then again, that doesn't quite work. So essentially, you can see I've essentially dismantled three houses: the abstract painting, the traditional legacy, and the technique, and none of them fully capture what he's doing. Then you might say, okay, what is it that he's doing? And so today I'm going to take you through that question and find an answer for that. So in order to make it have a broad perspective on this, and I just make use of the chart that I use for my film, that, by the way, I'm making a film about Liu Kuo-sung's career. So, and this is a provisional chart. There are other ways of summarizing or dividing different stages of his career. So this is just a placeholder, but it serves us well in taking you through different moments of his career. And I will probably briefly mention that 1938 was significant. He was born in 1932, and then in 1938, his father took him to a theater, and then his father left for Wuhan, and he died in the Battle of Wuhan. And then Liu Kuo-sung essentially became a half orphan, and then suffered the social dislocations and so forth. So that's the sort of Wuhan, to some extent, is a starting point of his difficult life and the career that he went through, and also leave a deep impact on the way he relates to the world. And there's a great deal of dislocation, migration in the wartime, and then he went to Taiwan in 1949, across the, and then so on. So I will go through the chart, this timeline, and also we can use some iconic paintings to anchor what is each moment in his career that what he's doing. In other words, Liu Kuo-sung become Liu Kuo-sung, it takes such a longer time. In fact, he's one of those who's constantly renewing his art, constantly changing. That's why Liu Kuo-sung's art is so fascinating. He doesn't stay stable. He has been constantly changing, as you can see from the different variety of forms that he went through. All right, I want to start maybe with a historic photograph showing Liu Kuo-sung practicing outdoor sketching on Mount Ali in Taiwan. And this is a very interesting photograph and actually contains a lot of information. And I might want to set this against the background of two masters who went to Taiwan from mainland, like Liu Kuo-sung, but one generation earlier. One is Puru, who nearly became the last emperor, and certainly played out in certain ways that he didn't become last emperor, but he went to Taiwan. And because of the imperial heritage, he was quite celebrated and had an impact in the art world. And then there's Huang Jingbi, who also was transplanted from mainland China to Taiwan. So the two of them were quite influential figures. Each had its own notion of how to do Chinese painting. And by the way, there's also interesting division between the northerner and southerner. So he's a northerner, imperial. He's a southerner, revolutionary. But somehow they were the kind of background for Liu Kuo-sung's painting. Huang Jingbin in particular was, he was quite authoritative. And so he was essentially establishment. And he also taught at the school that Liu Kuo-sung was an art student. So in any case, he advocated for the outdoor sketching. And so it, in fact, not just him, all Liu Kuo-sung's teachers at that time, you know, they all advocated that you need to go out to do the outdoor sketching, which is very by contrast with the kind of practice that Puru would have. Puru is this traditional painter who essentially say, well, Chinese painting doesn't need to do outdoor sketching. All you need to do is just copy masters. And you borrow formulas, and then you work with the formula, and you produce landscape painting. So you have two different approaches. And as a student, Liu Kuo-sung obviously had to follow somewhat what the teacher advised, and obviously he joined the trip to Mount Ali. And here's what's interesting about his sketching trip. If you go to Mount Ali, which I did as well, in order to feel what it's like to visit Mount Ali, you were taken away, your breath was taken away by looking at these, you know, landscapes. And obviously, the whole point of going to Mount Ali up there is to sketch what's out there, the cloudscape, the beautiful scenery, and so forth. But Liu Kuo-sung didn't do that. Instead, he turned around. Instead of looking at the cowscapes and so forth, he turned around and looked at a railway tunnel. And this is a remarkable fact. In fact, in order to find that tunnel, I took my team and just went all over places in Mount Ali. And finally, we found it. This is a photo I took. I found the Mount Ali tunnel, which is already in disuse. This railroad is already in disuse. So, but the whole point is that the railroad train ride is very important for Liu Kuo-sung's career. Before he went to Taiwan, he made the final visit to Wuhan where his mother stayed, and mother bid him farewell at the train station and handing him a ring, basically say, the next time I see you, I hope you'll be a fully grown man and I hope you flourish. And that didn't know that with that final bidding or farewell, it was not in the decades that they met again. So, and Liu Kuo-sung also with his classmates went on the train ride all over places before they arrived in Guangzhou where they crossed the strait to Taiwan. So train ride was had this deep, made a deep impression. And also during the, in the wartime, a lot of refugees took the train ride to go to places. And then you have people climbing under the train and then the train would go to the tunnel. And then some people would just, you know, basically died when the train hit the tunnel. And so it's a lot of tragic events. And it's to some extent, the train ride carries heavy historical memory, right? So so essentially, come back to Liu Kuo-sung and his teachers, they all carry heavy historical memory of the homeland of China as they knew, remember. And they all try to do in their own ways how to keep that memory alive and how to tap into that memory. So for the man who nearly became the last emperor, what he did was that use this blue and green landscape. So for those who don't know much about the convention of Chinese landscape painting, blue and green landscape were typically used to represent what is called xianjia sansui, meaning that it's an immortal land where it's the otherness, that you go to that place, you try to achieve certain immortality. So that otherness, but that's so other that it become unable to speak to the contemporary or modern sensibility. So what Puru did was to reform that, because if you were to do a typical blue and green, you do hard contour, and you use the flat surface of color. And so it's very pristine, but it's so other, right? So what he does is to use this. So this is essentially Tang mode. This is essentially Song mode. So he essentially uses Song mode to reform the Tang mode and to make it more worldly. For Huang Junbi, he used another way approach, which is that he will make everything so wet and so emotional. You know, Chinese landscape painting has certain colds. If you do a lot of wetness, it's a way of showing certain emotional flow, right? So we don't have time to go into all that detail. Just to say that they both, in their own ways, try to remember. They also resurrect a monumental landscape as a background. So, and except that they try to get to that monumentality in different ways. And in his case, he just made this more worldly, more accessible, and more relatable. And in his case, he just surrounded with a lot of clouds and mist and showing that, you know, from this side, looking up, back, reaching out, it takes some effort. And it's not that easy. So they both try their ways to create what's on this side and what's on the other side, right? So Liu Kuo-sung did his own thing. And obviously, as a good student, he also knew this compositional scheme, did all this formal approach well. But if you look at his early works, you feel like there's more going on. And these are one is a figure painting, mother and child. Another is a landscape painting. But you could see there's that angst, well, a certain kind of attachment to something out there that's beyond reach, right? Mother, memory of mother, memory of homeland, and so forth. So in other words, even though on the surface of them, they are all, this is a figure painting, this is a landscape painting, they were essentially doing the same thing, right? So, and that same thing is crystallized by this historic photograph that he carried. That's his mother, his half-sister, he's married, remarried after his father died. And that's Liu Kuo-sung, I think it's, you know, around 1940, in the 1940s anyways. So, but here's one interesting document we just, the Liu Kuo-sung Foundation just excavated and shared with me, which is that in 1952, Liu Kuo-sung actually, as a college student in Taiwan, wrote a piece of fiction. And that piece of fiction is quite powerful. So what he did is that he created this scenario, and there is this 13-year-old named Da Jingzi. Yeah. 13 years old, and when she was born, after she was born, about 3 years after she was born, her father died in the Sino-Japanese War on the battleground. And the government has some subsidy, but it's so minimal that it couldn't quite sustain the whole family. So the whole family her mother has to support the whole family. And that was very hard, right? So even though it is fiction, everything was true. So Liu Kuo-sung, as a young author, was stating the facts, right? And so there was this, toward the end of that short story, there's a letter that arrived in mainland China. And the mother thought it was a joke, no, but the daughter essentially assured him that it was true. So in this letter, Liu Kuo-sung essentially was addressing his mother. He said, "Dear mother, since I arrived in Taiwan, I continued schooling. So make sure that everything is going well. I always want to write to you, but in this past year, half year, there's not a moment I didn't think about that warm and happy home I thought about you must also miss me at your children, kids, and so forth, and you know, keep well, and I hope. This is very important. Mother and son, there will be a day when we can get united. All right. This word, 团圆, united, is a very charged word, and you'll see that it will play out throughout the career of Liu Kuo-sung. Right. And the letter then ends up, is sister still so cute? And I pray to God that she is forever happy, and so on. So son, your son, so-and-so, because that's a piece of fiction, right? But you all know that everything he said was true, was factual. So that's what he did in writing. What about what was doing in painting? All right. So is there something that is related in the kind of writing he produced, the way through words he imagines things and through pictures? So let's look at this painting. This is a typical student painting, and but it's actually quite interesting. And there's a dream, and so for some reason this painting appealed to him. And this, of course, is modeled upon Cézanne. So as an art student, you copy what the established painter do. But what is interesting that soon he transformed that composition into something else. And very pointedly titled the painting Little Sister, and done in the same year. And obviously there's a certain form of borrowing. But except that he changed the hue, the tonality of it, so it becomes very warm, fuzzy, warm, with this pinkish background, and everything is sort of glowing with warmth. And you wonder why. And then if we revisit that short story, you start to make sense. She was only 13, and her father died 3 years after she was born. And father died in the Sino-Japanese War, and everything relies on mother's support. So essentially what I'm suspecting, and we can ask him during the Q&A, I'm suspecting that he's making a composite figure. There's a bit of the half-sister and a bit of mother being made into a composite figure that anchors. And then what's also interesting that the figure has no eyes. So it's probably a way of showing certain dreamy state and so forth. Again, we can ask him during the Q&A. All right, so, and also that warm and happy home, and explain the glow, the warmth of it. Is the sisters continue to be that cute and so on, right? So we know that he essentially lived with the memory, and this is the half-sister, the mother, being composited into one figure. And then we know from the later photographs that preserve, this is a sister that grows older, his mother. And then this is the photo we recently took. She still lives in Wuhan, and we sent our team there, right? So this gives you a good starting point, and what are we going to do, and this is real stuff, is that as Eugene Tan rightly said, you know, all this 7 days, decades or so long career of art is essentially summarized here. So what I'm doing here is to use 9 paintings by Liu Kuo-sung, each anchoring one particular period. And I'm going to selectively, hopefully we can take you through these 9 phases of his career, and to see how Liu Kuo-sung become Liu Kuo-sung. All right, so we start with the 1960, and that's the way Liu Kuo-sung felt like I really became an artist. So that we actually, I'm compiling a catalog resume for Liu Kuo-sung's work, and we were discussing the early works, and he said, well, no, I'm only start with the 1960, but so to honor his wish here, but in the catalog resume, we actually do 50s work. But here we started with the 1960. 1960, it's called I Came Here to Listen to the Heavenly Speeches, 我来此地闻天语. It's a very powerful work. The question I want to ask here is, how did he become an ink painter? So the 1960s was actually a good moment to probe that question, ask that question. So this was actually not, this is not an ink painting, but it has everything to do with the kind of ink painting he produced, right? So what you notice is that regardless of what the title says, there's a certain formal drama going on here. The formal drama is always that there is something somber, dark, heavy in the background at the base. And then there's also some kind of overlayering of that dark base. So what formally it creates is that drama of there's something deep and there's something made to cover, either to cover that or to reveal that. So that became one of the deep psychological drama that Liu Kuo-sung also play with. There's something deep there. Either I want to bury that, or I want to reveal it, or I want to excavate it. So that struggle, that tension between what is above and what is beneath is part of the game. Right? So, and you will see similar things being worked out. And here's a photograph, a historic photograph of Liu Kuo-sung in his studio and doing a lot of these similar works. But presumably, and he was using a different kind of brush that was used for oil painting. So, and this is a painting that continues that, and it is another oil painting built on. But you could see the same kind of dynamic going on here. There's a dream of the homeland, and there's some attempt to cover that dream. So constantly there's something in the at the baseline, something overlaying it. And the tension between the two is what makes his art really interesting. And by the way, I actually took this photo in the storage room, the Art Institute of Chicago. There are two of them. And it's quite striking and impressive seeing these in flesh. And I immediately text Lin Hui. I say, I feel like if Liu Kuo-sung continued to be oil painter, he will be just as successful and interesting and probably rewrite the history of oil painting. But he chose not to do so. But you won't kind of understand why. So this is the shift. And from that oil medium, he shifted to ink medium. So the point for me and for us is that even though these are different mediums, they are actually all doing the same thing. They're all about how to work with that tumultuous inner feeling, using symbolic acts of either covering up or revelation. Right? So, and 1961 is a very turbulent time. There was a flood in Taiwan. He was getting married. His first daughter was born. You know, a lot of happening. So all that stuff is too turbulent, and you could see that turbulence going on. And then, of course, when you have all these natural disasters hitting Taiwan, you also think about the homeland, your mother, and so forth. So, you know, it's hard to sort them out. Therefore, you know, this kind of form really capture that inner turmoil. So keep that in mind, but this is a starting point when he converted, well, he became an ink painter. And then that started a long career. So that's 1960. And then now move to 1962. Four, and this painting is in at Harbor. I often teach this painting to the students. This actually tells us a lot about what kind of so-called abstract art is about at this time, because he was doing a lot of abstract strokes, but you know it's only part of the story. Oftentimes, if you look closely at the similar works produced in the period, again, that same dynamic that I spelled earlier, is at work here.
So there's always something covering things up.
And then there is this very dynamic brushstroke winding its way, trying to get out and trying to break out of that ground. So there's always some kind of groundwork, something deep going on psychologically. And there's some kind of covering up, either snow or the grass, and finally, in this case, at the Harvard painting, this tension of the black and white, the deep and the surface, get resolution in this mountain climb. And there's some kind of sublimation. So that's why in the title of my talk, there's that word, transcendence. And you will see Liu Kuo-sung's career is about transcendence. How to first get mired in certain kind of wilderness, but then how to break out of that and get to another state. Right? So that's is a big story of Liu Kuo-sung's own career. So that's 1964. And we can now get to 1966. By the way, 1960s, it was really when his career took off. So we spent a lot of time talking about 1960s. And this is actually quite powerful painting. And I already mentioned briefly that, you know, in some way it resulted from his encounter with Frank Quinn's monumental landscape painting. And he really was struck by the awe-inspiring monumental landscape of the Song tradition. But on the other hand, we should also pause to reflect on the fact that he wasn't, in other words, if you are completely so overwhelmed by it, and you're like, okay, the next logical thing is that you just do what Fan Huang was doing. But that's not the case here. So he actually was doing something else. So the reason he was doing that at that time, there were certain art school motto you follow. And in that case, I think the Western modernist painting does have some effect. Basically, when you think about the modernist rule of thumb is that there's a line, there's a dot, there's a plane. You work with these three elements. So what he felt was that the Chinese painting is very good at line, very good at dots, but probably not so good at planarity. And when he saw this painting, he said, oh my God, they actually have a lot of planarity there. So he would use that and transplant that here. But the formal concern is not everything. What the contrast between those is that quite interesting. So what Frank Quine's painting was doing here is actually to show that, you know, nature stays, human affairs are transitory. So there's a transitory state of the human affairs as a tiny travelers down there who are very insignificant in relation to this monolith of landscape. So the unchanging landscape versus the changing human affairs creates certain pathos. That's what essentially this monumental landscape is about. Liu Kuo-sung is doing something else, right? He borrowed the planarity of this landscape, as you can see here, but he collaged that into the composition instead of just paint one. By creating collage, there's a sense that this is something other, this is something different, right? And then the foreground, there was that very dynamic brushstroke. So what he's doing here is really create two kinds of section. One is about here, now, there's a lot of energy going on, a lot of emotional flow. Then there's something that is being recreated out there, remembered, distant in time and space, qualitatively different from the here and now. And what is also interesting that essentially is the sort of tablet of memory that you try to preserve. And this is trying to react to that memory. So this is a very subtle painting, very powerful in that it is really in a dialogue. There is something being remembered and there's something doing the memory. doing the remembering. So there's a here and there's a then, and it's in some kind of dialogue. And that also looks forward to the future development. As you can see, eventually that memory lane becomes identifiable with the present. And then sometimes there's an eagerness to get into that realm. So it's almost like the presence here jump to the other space. And then eventually that jumping takes place on the moon, whereas you can see he collaged himself, or not himself, his outer ego, outer ego on the moon, but that shadow picks up where this dynamic structure was trailing on the ground. So essentially say, well, I know this is illusionary, but I'm going to do it anyway, right? So that's the moment, and this is the exciting moment, 1969, and he created a whole series of works, initially taking cue from the kind of lantern design for mid-autumn festivals, and then evolved that into the moon, where the dynamic presence can get onto, and in which case you will see similar dynamic going on here, right? So what I'm going to do is to play a little clip of what the film that I'm directing trying to stage that moment.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon.
Command coming in now, and we are on the automatic sequence.
Of So my dad first came across that image of the earth. It just really completely, you know, moved him because my dad really never had a home. The image of the earth, where you look at the image and you can tell that's your home. And yet, when you look at the image, the home is so far away and you're at the moon. I wonder if sometimes that's how he feels, that he is maybe on the moon, looking at the earth and looking at his home. You finally can have an image in your head, but yet it feels very, very far away. Maybe that was why it's so compelling and moving for him. He now knows what the home looks like, a very, very pretty image, but at the same time, it feels you cannot really touch it. That's maybe my interpretation.
So from the 60s, we quickly move on to the 70s when Liu Kuo-sung went to Hong Kong, and things start to change also because of the circumstances in Hong Kong. And for the sake of time, we don't have much time, so maybe I'll quickly get to the story there, which is that in Hong Kong, he felt closer to his mother, and in that reflects it in the kind of compositions where the warm astral globe start to take warmth and closer to the planet Earth, and they're getting the what used to be separated entities start to get closer. And in fact, his mother did, through certain arrangement, his mother did come to Hong Kong to join him. So then, due to complicated reasons that things didn't quite work out, then she went back to home, China, mainland China. So there's also a clip that I can play here, and that essentially gives the some of the background story. Thank you.
妈妈，许久没收到您的信了，一切还好吗？您做的四双小鞋已经收到了，小玉非常喜欢您做的鞋，她常常指着鞋告诉别人，这是奶奶做的。亲爱的妈妈，马上就是您的60岁大寿了，如果您老人家在香港与我们一起多好，可是上面还是不让您出来，您以后多去同他们说说，多说几次，也许会批准您出来。母亲，近来安好，小女令会上一声。母亲，问候近安，我托朋友帮助您来香港的事宜。母亲，降压药同信一同给您寄去。母亲，弟弟妹妹近来如何？您若来香港，请一道把弟弟带上，也让他在香港完成学业。妹妹出落得越发漂亮了，但还是我记忆里那个老样子。
就是受人欺负，有时候委员会来就是把我们家的那个煤篓子就抬走了，那我们家就没饭吃了。
我说那个时候你没得这个经济来源，说我妈妈也跟我说蛮多钱，因为我毕竟是个小孩子，我总要她陪伴，可她这个买菜呀、都是半夜，晚上也看不见，铲到那个石头打下来了，我看到妈妈我就走到那一头，我妈妈老回打过来，手里打过来，我们再不卖菜了。我说好好好，不卖。
送我妈在火车上去的时候是单程的，她是去的可以不回的，我妈就是挑头看了我一下，跟我打了一下招呼，我妈就进去了。应该是在那边待了4个月，他就回来了。到家以后呢，又住到老房子去了。是我哥原来在武汉住的就是那个房。结果我妈那个思想呢，就想到我哥就在那个小房里面住。所以他晚上就去敲人家门，敲人家门呢，结果人吵了人家的那个睡眠， 就把我妈打了一顿，打得还是蛮厉害的。
I'm not sure how much time I've left. Let's see. So 1980s, from the 70s to 1980s, there's another big change. How are we doing in terms of time? Okay. So maybe we can, maybe, well, this is not going to be finished anyways. So maybe we can end with a clip of the final moment of this talk that shows the, yeah, we can do that maybe. When he went to Himalayas, that was an extraordinary moment in his career.
请我去讲学，我就提出了一个要求，请他们带我去看珠穆朗玛峰。是我这一生里边真正体会出来什么叫做风。
So I essentially will end there, because that's the image that the clip ended with. And this is a quite powerful image in that it kind of dissolves the other side and the surface, so that you, what is beyond and what is here become one together. And so that's the sort of fitting ending to that film, but also fitting one of the final triumphant moment in Liu Kuo-sung's life and career, when all these decades he's been trying to get out of that mired worldliness and transcend to a higher level. And then finally the resolution is achieved through this kind of pictorial language, where the other, the remote otherness and the present, the rememberer and the remembered, all dissolve into one unified form. All right. So sorry I take too much time, but happy to take questions when we get to the Q&A period. All right, thank you very much.
谢谢汪教授的精彩演讲哦，尤其这个演讲中还有电影片段，那这个电影呢就是很快就会完成，我们应该是还有机会跟大家分享，在下一个阶段这个展览的学术和公共活动中，希望我们就可以推出这个影片。那现在我们就是节省时间，让汪教授呢和刘老师呢有一个对谈，好吧？
刘老师，我有一个问题一直很想问你，因为我记得我上次去你的那个工作室
在台北和上海的，那我就发现呢，你到那段时间至少你就基本不画山了，就是画水，而且那段时间只画水，好像你还跟我说你还没完全搞明白这个水应该怎么画，但是你那个时候正在努力想一个办法怎么把水给表现出来。所以呢，我因为对您的整个创作都比较熟悉，我知道您对山的执着是多少年多少跨了一个很长的一个历史跨度，然后最终就不再看山了，然后就注意水。所以我就想听听您为什么发现了这么一个转变。
那个画家呀，他的画的发展都是靠这个自然界或者他的这个接触面给他的一种感受或者感动。因为那个时候我去了最美丽的九寨沟，那个时候又听到人家说九寨沟怎么美怎么美，所以我就特别跑去感受。结果到那里之后，我发现那个他们所谓的海子其实都是湖，但是每一个湖的颜色都不一样，而且我那个时候去的时候，它这个因为这个那个在山上，它一层一层的在山上，所以在不同的层次，它那个风又不一样。哎呀，说那个风吹到那个水面上，那个水面那个波纹，然后那个波纹，然后再看到那个波纹里面那个山和那个树木的一个倒影，哎呀，那真美呀！我从来没有感受不到那么美的这个水，所以因为感动的不得了，说回去脑子里满脑子都是水。所以我就 想怎么样能够把那个美丽的那个水那个波纹把它表现出来。所以我就试左试右试，用各种样的中国纸试，都试不出来。结果这个那个时候说是我一个画家在他表现不出来的时候那种痛苦。就大家那个也有可能也许有人可以体会。所以那个时候我就整天的就坐在那就想。这个忽然之间呢我就想到一种纸。是我在台湾那个中央理工学院建筑系教书的时候。那个晚上我没有事我就跑到教室里去看那个学生画那个建筑图。画那个建筑图的那个纸啊是个半透明的那种外国纸。说我当时的时候我还摸它的纸蛮好玩的，那又半透明的又像玻璃一样那种感觉。这个后来我就忽然间脑子一想，哎，我说这所有的中国纸我用所有的我过去的技法都表现不出我那个感受来，怎么办？我说我来试试这个描图纸好了。结果就这个用那个描图纸我就试怎么试怎么试，我就这个后来我就把这个描图纸，我因为我画画都在地上画，所以我就把描图纸放在地上，然后我就把宣纸啊就铺在上面，我就把它打水，那打水把它打湿，打湿之后啊那我就在上面滴颜色，就是我就去滴那个所谓我在那个水里面感受的那个颜色。结果后来三弄两弄啊，结果弄了之后哎慢慢的发现哎很好玩了。哎，结果因为那个描图纸啊它一打湿了之后呢它就皱了。这而且这个皱的时候呢都是横着线的皱。说我那个宣纸上去的时候我把打湿然后颜色滴上去，然后那个颜色呢就那水那个纸这个在那个描图纸上一打湿之后呢，它那因为那个本来纸跟描图纸两个中间呢有很多空气，说水洒上去之后呢它那个有很多的空气都留在那个中间，而且呢那个描图纸皱的时候呢它是横着皱的，所以嘛它那个结果呢那个颜色就从那个宣纸上透到下面那张描图纸上，说那个有它有的贴上去的时候就有颜色，它个中间有空气的地方两个纸没有贴在一起之后呢就变成白的。哎，结果后来我就发现哎，这个倒有意思，那个白的那个感觉呢有点像反光，有那个阳光上去之后那个，而且呢它那个纸呢是横的皱的，哎，它就有横的一条一条的线，哎，慢慢我就觉得这个哎这个有这个水的波纹的那个效果了。结果就在这样的一个情形之下就面慢慢的我就越来越开心了。
开心就好。那我们现在再把这个记忆拉回到60年代，因为60年代是您的创作的非常关键的一个阶段，因为很那么有一个问题呢我一直也想问，就是这个您当时看那个范宽的那个西山行旅图好像是1961年， 因为是国民政府要出国展览，然后再又出口转内销，然后就在台湾也展，然后您又有机会看到了那个范宽的那个西山行旅图，当时你很震撼，你也跟我说，你说当时看的鸡毛疙瘩都起来了。我的问题是这样，就是那个画对你那么震动，但是您画这个矗立那个系列是1966年，这个当中隔了大概有5年，我就想，哎，为什么要等5年之后才从绘画上回应那个？这是第一个问题。第二个问题，我觉得矗立这个系列非常好，这个太重要了啊！这个它创造了一个主体跟客体之间的这种关系，然后记忆者和这个被记忆的这种心中丰碑的这种关系是非常非常复杂。这个话是真的是很了不起啊！它开拓了一个这种心灵和宇宙这种关系就记忆的这么一个机制，创造了一种很有效的方式，把一种内心的对话给表现出来。但是您，我记得您跟我说过，你画了一阵就不想画那个了，你觉得画画好像觉得你要扬弃它，所以我就觉得，哎，那你为什么要扬弃它？这不好好的吗？所以我的问题等于两个，第一个就是我再重复一遍，第一个问题就是，哎，61年看到范宽西山行旅图，要等到66年才做个回应，当中有五年的空格。第二就是说这个画很成功，但是你怎么又放弃它呢？这种形式，
这个非常有意思。因为当时美国就希望这个故宫博物院，就台湾收藏的故宫博物院的一些文物到美国去展览，结果消息一出来之后呢，香港的大公报啊就出来一篇文章，说是这个你们看啊，台湾的当局啊，这个已经没办法活下去了，就要把故宫的东西拿到美国去卖。结果就因为他这一篇文章啊，给我们帮了很大的忙，因为台湾政府就怕以后这个事情真的变成所以他就在出去之前呢，就在台北展览一次，等到回来之后再展一次，就表示什么多少东西出了去，多少东西回来。因为那个时候的这个故宫的东西啊，都藏在那个台中的那个山洞里面，根本不可能看到。所以结果在这个展出的时候呢，那就非常轰动，大家都急着去看。那我也就赶着第一天最早的一批人进去看，一进去第一张画就看到这个在那一面大墙上就挂着的范宽的这个西山行旅，因为这个西山行旅很大，是那个传统的那种丝质的那个卷呢、啊，是2张卷拼在一起的，那个就很宽很高很大，所以我就是一下子站到那个前面之后一看那个画之后，就感觉了一股冷风冲下来，我浑身起鸡皮疙瘩。其实哪里有冷风嘛，就是完全受他感动的这个起鸡皮疙瘩。说当时啊，我是在台湾鼓吹抽象画了， 觉得抽象画，那个时候我还写文章，我说抽象画才是真正的画。他说过去那些这个具象画都是一种说明性质的绘画，它不是纯粹的，应该我们绘画应该像音乐一样完全的抽象，才是真正中国的，就这个绘画才真正走到它自己的本身的呈现，而不是说明性质的。但是结果一看到范宽那个那么写实的绘画，结果我反对写实，结果到那儿之后就有这么大的感动。结果后来我一想，我的宣传抽象画，我而且那个时候已经这个看了很多的抽象画呀，我说是觉得抽象画很这个不错，但从来没有这样感动过。说我这个这样的人，结果这一年两年下来，我脑子里一直忘不了这张画。说到最后为什么我五年之后，就是因为这个五年呢，我这张对于这个范宽这张画，我就一直在我这个脑子里，一直在我感受里面，一直忘不了。说后来我在想，我说我能不能啊，用我的方法把我对范宽这个西山行旅的那个感受把它画出来。所以我就开始这个做那个出力，结果呢我就给我的这个感受呢，我就觉得这个范宽这个大山呢就像一个墓碑。我说这个一个墓碑的那个重量，那个力量，你知道吧？说我后来我就把一张纸裁成一个墓碑的一个形状，然后再画，画了之后呢贴上去。这个下面这个部分的这个画了一些这个人物那个这种，所以那个部分呢，我就用这个所谓的石刻的乔欣冲的狂和笔，说我这都是这对我有很大的感受的一种做法。结果我这个那一年里面啊，大概我就做了十来张，结果说什么我都没办法把那个感受弄出来，我就发现我这个没办法，我这个表现能力还是很差，说到最后我只好放弃了。
哦，是放弃，不是阳气。我另外很想知道的，就是因为我也可以把这个图调出来，就是这一张是在我们哈佛您在1971年画的，
是哪一张？
就是右边右上面，对对对对对对，是当时您送给李竹敬先生的啊，
是是
啊啊，这个1971年的，那是应该是在香港画的，啊，那么我觉得很有意思，就是几个问题啊，第一个呢，就是您这辈子颠沛流离，对流离的体验，对到身到异地。怎么去适应异地的环境，同时又保持自己的记忆，然后通过您的绘画把这种离异感和颠沛流离的这种感受给传达出来。那么我觉得我一直很好奇的就是您去了香港之后，因为我也知道您去香港当时也是斟酌了一番，当然两天就答应了就去了，那对您来说又是另外一次离异。那么我想听听您到香港之后整个 香港的这个新的环境，当时对您的创作有没有一定的这个也产生一些效用啊？这是一个问题，就是香港的环境，您的这个新的一次离异的这个体验，您当时怎么感受的啊？另外一个就是这幅画，我觉得也很有意思。你当然是用了水踏啊，但是它跟当时其他的七十年代的画都还不太一样。就七十年代其他的画都是要表现这个天体和大地快要接触，然后整个画面呈比较温暖的一个色调。这幅画呢，有一点点温暖的那么一丝丝的这种红色的这个，因为大概是这个水特造成的一些效应，但总体来说它是比较怪异比较奇特。在您的整个作品的群体的之中来说，这画也还是比较奇特的一幅画。那我想这个背后有没有一些具体的人事和一些其他的情境造成了这幅画的这种特异的品质。也就是说，再说两个问题，第一个就是您到香港的感受对您创作的影响，第二就是这幅画你们有没有背景我们能够跟我们分享一下。
这是我因为当年这个从事于水墨画的改革创新的时候，有很多的这个打击，就传统派的这些画家，这个对我的打击很大。说为了要跟他们辩论，说结果我就读了大量的中国古书，中国美术史方面的一些书籍，还有文化方面的一些书籍。结果后来我就在一篇这个美术史的文章里面呢，就看到有这么一个记载，就说中国绘画除了文人画之外呢，还有民间画，还有年画，还有这个版画，还有这个完了之后呢，还有火画和水画。哎，我看了这个记载之后，我说其他的画我都知道，但是这个水画跟火画这两个名词，我们就不知道这是什么样的画了，你知道吧？结果后来我就做实验，我一开始就做火的实验，火画的实验。我想火画当然跟火有关了，所以我就拿那个蜡烛啊，那烟纸熏这个纸，我又拿那个香啊，这个点了烧那个点的那个我们进神那个香。然后点着了之后去烧那个纸，你知道吧？结果我做了很久啊，都没做出这个满意的作品，就是觉得好像是一张画的这种作品没做出来。当然这个后来这个被那个叫什么呢？
王天德。
对，
他们
还蔡国强，说被他们这两位画家就把火画给发展出来了。那个时候我就那我就试试水画吧。那我想这个水画那跟水一定有关，跟墨一定有关。说那个时候我们画传统国画的时候，那个笔里面那个墨太浓的时候，我们就去蘸水，蘸完水之后就发现那个墨就有很多这个墨的就浮在那个水上面。哎，我想那个跟那个一定有关， 说我就开始用洗脸盆，然后弄上水，然后把墨给滴上去，哎，就发现那个墨呀，它那个比重比水轻，因为它是烟，不是烟做的嘛。说的，但是也当然，一滴上去的时候，它也有很多沉下去，但是总有一些浮在水面上。那我就拿那个宣纸去往上面一站呢，宣纸是个吸水纸，说它一吸上来之后，就把那个水面上那个墨纹就吸上吸上去了。哎，我说这个大概跟这个有关了。结果我就拿那脸盆试来试去试，结果在台湾那个时候呢，试了一阵子，也没有这个试出很满意的来。后来就完成了我那后来那个抽象的那个狂草笔法的那个画，结果就把那个水托这个事情呢又放下了。结果到了香港之后呢，那个我本来是请我去一年访问的，结果后来就留下来叫我做系主任，改革那个系。那说改革那个系的话，我这个做了系主任之后，那我就有权利开新课，我就开了一个现代水墨画的课。那个我开这个现代水墨画的课，因为我的脑子是实验，一定要代替临摹。所以说那个时候我就提出一个口号来，我说我这个画室是实验室，你知道吧？所以说不是传统绘画制造的工厂。说那个时候呢，那我就要教这个学生一些新的技法，给他们一些启发，让他们去自己做实验。说那个我教了一些那个纸托呀，水什么托完了之后，我想这个水托这个地方我还是要这个教他们，因为我虽然我自己还没试验出满意的绘画来，但是这个技法我说我还是希望去介绍他给们。说那个时候我就自己要开始就做大量的水托了，对。说因为要教这个技法给他们，我还要做出这个作品来给他们看，这用这个技法可以做出什么样的画来。说我又开始回来实验这个水墨，所以我就从那个时候我就做了一批算是很满意的水墨的画。那说是这个水墨画是这样的发展出来的。你那个第二个问题是什么？
就是说这幅画本身还是挺特别啊，就是我所以想问问。
对，因为这个技法很特别，它表现出来的效果跟我那个狂草的那个大笔法完全相悖。一个是很强烈的一种表现，这个呢是很细腻的一种这个感觉，那个表现的感觉。说的一个是粗大的，一个是细小，我就觉得这个细小这个玩意儿也蛮好玩的。说的这张画呢，说老实话，是我那个时候做了很多的这个水托的技法呀，我把它这个拼贴在一块儿，说你们看这里面的这些。这一块一块一块是很多块贴到一起。说的那个时候之前我不是做这个太空画吗，我那个时候就很就发现了，我做的这个早期的做的这个水托呀，做了
做完了之后我老觉得没有完成，为什么呢？因为没有中间没有那个圆。所以说你们可以看到这个，这是我的那个做那个水托的时候，那个水托的那个没有一张完整的一个水托画，所以就把那个不完整的水托画呢，就把它切来拼贴，拼贴完了之后又加上一个圆。所以说后来我就因为这个原因啊，就花了好大的力量才把那个圆从我的画里面赶出去。所以说后来我因为有了这个感觉之后啊，我蛮同情那个文人画家，他们画了这个临摹了那多久的那个画，你说让他放弃，他怎么放弃得了呢？说绝对弄这种丢不掉，是。
好的，因为时间的关系我们短一点，那还有肯定很多观众想问汪教授问题，那我先问汪老师一个问题哈，就是刚才你的美术史叙述有一部分是通过你的电影表达的，那我就想问个问题，为什么你会去拍这个电影？你觉得它是一种新的美术史的表达方法吗？
这个问题很好，我想是这样的，我们在体验刘老师的绘画的时候呢，都有一种很强的感受，这其实不是我一个人，很多人都有的感受，就是第一，他们觉得就是经常在画里听到声音。所以刘老师早期在1961年左右的那些绘画里也会说，60年初期的时候说我来此地闻天宇等等的，这种就是声音的感觉特别强。也就是说跟其他画家比起来，刘老师的绘画特别有一种我们现在叫来就是多媒体效应，就是他似乎是激发了你去要用那种多媒体的方式深化一种复杂的方式去感受他的绘画。所以呢我就觉得要真正体验到刘老师的绘画，有时候还真的要调动这些樱花效果来发掘他的那个声音。尽管他画面是一个似乎是很安静，但是其实背后都是也是汹涌的，几乎是交响式的一种声音。这是促使我很想用电影这个手段来表现。第二就是刘老师的绘画他上天入地，就是特别有那种电影效果。我们今天没有时间，如果有时间的话以后有机会可以讨论一下，就是这个1988年的这个30变奏，我觉得是非常非常的cinematic， 就是这种电影效果的一种表现。所以但更重要的我觉得是刘老师的绘画承担了一个历史的重任，不管他自己是有意无意意识到这个还不了，但是我就觉得说其实中国文化一直需要一种载体，这个在学界讨论也很多，就是说中国到底有没有史诗 epic，这个问题在文学史界讨论很多，有的人说哎呀这个诗经就是我们的 epic 但是这个大家也还是有争议，那有人说这个问题本身就是错的，就是你为什么非得有 epic 呢？中国有诗经就行了，不需要有 epic， 不需要有史诗。但是其实在至少在杜甫开始吧，经过安史动乱，有杜甫这样的诗人，他就承担了某一种后人称之为诗史，这个 poetic history， 这个所谓的诗史它不是说 history of poetry， 并不是诗歌的历史，而是说通过某种想象的形式来重新表现历史的动荡，历史的感受。那么杜甫提出了杜甫的诗是也是可以说是能够 表现安史之乱那种动荡感的那种大史诗的一种创作，然后到了清初的时候又一次提出了这个要求，就是很多像钱谦益啊，很多这种诗人就说我们需要一种诗史，就是 poetic history。 然后有的画家甚至说什么是绘画，绘画就是嚎叫，绘画就是林间的嚎叫，这种粗语都惊人，你根本就很难想象当时的诗人或画家有这种需要。所以呢，但是你再来看绘画这个怎么对这个问题回应的，你又发现就是说能够承担起诗史这样的画家不多。我觉得在清初的时候，龚贤是一个诗史的一个承担起用绘画来表现诗史的这么一个画家。那么到二十世纪有很多种种复杂的原因，大家都做过尝试，我其中李可染我觉得是也是想做这样的事。因为李可染说起来这个里面还有一些因缘我们今天也没时间说。1938年刘国松的父亲在武汉战场去世，李可染就在武汉。李可染在武汉而不仅他就当时参与了当时一个巨大的一个
黄鹤楼，是
黄鹤楼绘画，对对对对对，当时是一个以蒋委员长为首，千军万马去抵抗日军的这么一个大型绘画。从那个之后，刘可染就觉得中国绘画应该有一种公共性，应该也能够承担起某一种大的想象，所以他一生也在追求这个东西。种种历史原因，他有他的做法，有成功之处，也失败之处。所以我觉得刘老师他是一个很难得的一个案例，因为他经过了那么多颠沛流离，然后呢始终有一股，就是刘老师绘画有一种气，他那个气是在回荡在他那个绘画的空间里面，同时呢也让这个观者会有一种共鸣。而且他的那个走过的不同阶段，就像我们就看出来他是把一个民族的心路历程传达出来。所以最好的例证可以说就是80年代，刘老师重返大陆，当时大陆的对刘老师的绘画反应非常强烈，因为经过70年代的磨难之后呢，大家都有一种心理需要。今天我们没时间，那个片子里有一段，就是当时的一些诗人，像苏婷啊、北岛啊，他们这些人用的那些诗句里面的有些意象，跟刘老师的绘画的某一种有一种同构的感觉。也就是说当时大陆的很多敏感的年轻人都想有一种新的语言把他们的心声给传达出来，但是这个时候他们就感觉到好像这个视觉语言还找不到，所以80年代就很强切的要寻找一种新的视觉语言，把那种经过70年代磨难之后的那种内心的复杂的情绪和感觉给传达出来，没有找到。突然刘国松出现了，出现了之后他的这个这种非常震撼的视觉语言和大陆的很多年轻人的那种心理需要一拍即合，这也就解释了说当时在刘国松的绘画在大陆掀起所谓的刘国松热，它是有心理层面的一个原因的，就不是说大家就觉得新鲜，我觉得新鲜还不能解释当时的这个刘国松的效应，主要还是他回答了某一种心理的需要。而这种东西呢，我觉得回到您的问题，就是说也许只能通过电影的阐释把那种心理的层面的东西视觉化和听觉化，是这样的。
谢谢，讲得非常详细而且展开来了，
就又把刘老师的作品进行了更深的一个阐述，尤其是后阶段。那我想公平起见，我们留一个问题给观众，好吧？有没有什么问题？我们因为时间关系，可能只可以有一个问题。
这还是中国的这种。
如果没有，那我就问了哈。那大家都不问嘛，对吧？那刘老师刚才包括汪教授，汪教授就讲到有些东西没法表述了，通过电影的媒介。刘老师也说了你创作中的挣扎，很多东西表现不出来。所以有一个问题就是，绘画是不是终结了？因为这么难表现，那是不是需要别的方法了？绘画还有前途吗？刘老师，从你的角度看，架上绘画还有前途吗？
是，绘画它是一种墙上的艺术，这个不管你怎么样的发展，这个墙上这个艺术不可能消灭。说这个西方的绘画它跟东方的绘画完全的两样，一个是浓浊的，一个是这个怎么讲呢，一种这个东方的绘画很难形容，它是一个
比较婉约一点，流畅、流动的、
是个流动的，一个渲染的。说这两个领域完全不一样，西方那个浓浊的艺术已经发展得很厉害，但是东方的这个水墨画还恐怕还没有发展到一半。所以我觉得这个水墨画的发展将来还会
前景还是很宽阔，
很宽广，可以好好的发展的。说是现在有很多的这个西方的画家也都到东方来学水墨画了。说的我这个这个大陆的美术学院，不管是杭州的也好，北京的也好，成都的也好，我都去讲过学。我到那之后就发现有好多的外国画家在那学水墨画。那所以我们都发现这个纽约大都会美术馆的都展出水墨画了。那所以也就知道西方的艺术界对于水墨画的重视，也就证明了水墨画的将来的发展还是有很远的这个路可走。
好的，那我想我们今天的讨论就到这里，下次肯定还有机会，尤其是我们还有那个汪教授的那个就是这
个
作品那个电影的美术史叙述完成之后，我们还有那个对，那谢谢各位来聆听，这个也是很好的机会。那么我们的展览好像到今天晚上11点才关的，欢迎大家去展厅看，有不少作品都在展场。谢谢各位。